JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFT's daily market review for May the 14th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFT, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the dollar traded higher against all but one of the other G10 currencies on Wednesday and during the Asian morning Thursday. It gained the most versus SEC, Aussie, the pound and the euro in that order, while it underperformed only against the Japanese yen. Now, the strengthening of the dollar and the yen combined with the weakness in the Aussie suggests that risk appetite remains subdued for another day. Indeed, major EU and US indices were a sea of red yesterday, with the negative investor morale rolling into the Asian session today. Both Japan's Nikkei 225 and China's Shanghai composite are down 1.78 and 0.84% respectively. Following remarks by the leading US infectious disease expert Dr. Fauci that coronavirus vaccine may take some time to come out to the market, and his warning that removing restrictions too quickly will put lives back at risk, Fed Chair Powell came to add to investor concerns. Speaking in a webcast, the Fed chief warned over an extended period of weak growth and stagnant income due to the pandemic, while he made it clear that he and his colleagues are unlikely to push interest rates below zero. On top of that, global infections returned to acceleration mode the last couple of days, and we can see it on the graph here. The rising lines point to acceleration. The blue line is the day-by-day change in deaths, and the gray line is the day-by-day change in infectious cases. So, as I said, infections return to acceleration mode the last couple of days, increasing even further fears over a second wave of the virus. Now, our latest view was for further recovery in risk sentiment, but we've been highlighting the risk of reopening economies too quickly. Now, with expectations over a vaccine being ready soon diminishing, and with infections returning to acceleration mode, we prefer to sit to the sidelines and carefully monitor to see whether this will last for longer or whether this was something temporary. Everyone is suggesting that a V-shaped recovery in global economies is unlikely, but this is something already known, we believe. That's why we will not call for deeper declines in the equity world, but neither for decent rebounds. We prefer to wait for the fog to clear out. Now back to the currencies. The Aussie was the second loser in line, coming under decent selling pressure following Australia's employment data. The unemployment rate rose to 6.2% from 5.2% instead of surging to 8.3% as the forecast suggested. However, looking at the slide of the participation rate, the not too big increase in the unemployment rate may be due to many people losing their jobs and refraining from registering for unemployment benefits. Indeed, looking at the employment change, we see that the economy lost 594,300 jobs, which is the biggest plunge on record. At their latest meeting, RBA policymakers announced that they have scaled back their QE purchases, but the disappointing jobs data may have raised speculation that they could stop doing so and start scaling QE back up. That said, our own view is that officials are aware that data for March and April may come on the soft side. If the spreading of the coronavirus returns to a slowdown mode again, and at the same time governments around the globe continue easing their restrictions, we think that the prospect of better days may allow RBA policymakers to continue reducing their bond purchases. Now, as for today's events, from the US we get the initial jobless claims for last week. Although expectations are for a slowdown, they are still expected to see a strong jump once again. The forecast is for 2.5 million new claims, with continuing claims set to climb to 25.1 million from 22.65 million the week before. As for tonight, during the Asia Morning Friday, we have China's fixed asset investment, industrial production and retail sales, all for April. Fixed asset investment is expected to have fallen at a slower pace than in March, minus 10% year over year from minus 16.1%, while industrial production is expected to have rebounded 1.5% year over year after sliding 1.1%. Retail sales are expected to have slid 7.5% year over year after falling 15.8% in March. As for the speakers, we have three on today's agenda: Bank of Canada Governor Stephen Poulos, ECB Vice President Luis de Guindos, and Minneapolis Fed President Neil Kashkari. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock a.m. GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.